187. Let's get to the first film, which is Transformers from 2007, which is directed by Michael Bay. Stars Shia LaBeouf, Megan Fox, Josh Duhamel, Tyrese Gibson, Rachel Taylor, Anthony Anderson, John Voight, John Turturro. Pretty big cast. And the synopsis is an ancient struggle between two Cybertronian races, the heroic Autobots and the evil Decepticons, comes to Earth with a clue to the ultimate power held by a teenager. So this one is completely separate from the animated film. This really got Transformers back on the map and really made it into the franchise that we know it to be today. So it was a huge, huge film at the time. I remember when it came out, and it was very much a big film of my childhood, teenage years, so definitely left an impression, for better or for worse. And I've kept up with this live-action series for the most part. It's not a very good franchise, as we'll get to, but it still has a lot of interesting elements, and it had been a long time since I'd seen this first one. I remember having really liked it the last time I saw it. I've seen it maybe 3 or 4 times over the years. Starting from the beginning, and we'll get into Michael Bay as much as possible here, I think that what makes this movie work, it is a good launching point, for sure. It's not too long, it's fairly accessible, it's got good action, it was really Shia LaBeouf's and Megan Fox's big launch at the time, and it still has a lot of good fun, a lot of epic moments, and the classic Michael Bay-isms. But I feel like as the series has gone on, even though from a more objective, critical standpoint, this is one of the cleaner, more self-contained of all the installments, to me, this one almost is kind of boring because of how plain it is. Which, there aren't really other franchises where I say that, but I think with Michael Bay, the more bombastic that it becomes, the more interesting that it is. And usually that happens when you get sequels. And so going back and watching this, it's like, the character stuff is okay, surprisingly. You know, it's really not that offensively bad, but everything is so somewhat normal for Michael Bay, because this was the first, that it's a little drier than I was expecting. So I still think it's one of the better ones in the franchise, and if I want to go back and just watch a decent action movie, one of Michael Bay's better, more digestible films, this is a good one to go with. But some specifics. Shia LaBeouf, it's too bad what's happened to him personally over the years, because I really love Shia LaBeouf. I think he's a great actor. He's not amazing in this, but the writing is horrendous, and just the overall character of Sam Witwicky is cringeworthy, and Megan Fox is all right. I think she's grown a little bit over the years as an actor. The look of the movie, this is so like classic 2000s Michael Bay. Like he looks, I mean, still now really, but all of his movies for the most part look like they're shot in the 90s. They all look like the first Bad Boys, The Rock. He's someone who, even though he is very much an auteur and he has clearly been very, very successful, he's one of the most successful filmmakers box office wise of all time, so he's definitely doing something right to get audiences in seats. But if we're just purely talking about him creatively, he is one of the only filmmakers who has been around for a long time who has not really matured. If you look at someone like Spielberg, Scorsese, like any of the people who started out 70s, 80s, 90s, or even like Tarantino, who started more, you know, in the 90s, and Fincher as well, they have all grown and matured and changed up their styles to, for the most part, adapt with the times and really think, all right, how can I improve? How can I maybe make this a little bit sharper, a little bit smarter, you know, more restrained? And I feel like Michael Bay, you could really interchange the release dates of these different movies, and I would not be able to tell you which one came out when, like if I didn't know that already. And everything has to be shot at sunset for the most part. There are all these low angles, and really his cinematography and direction choices of where to put the camera comes from, to me, it seems like whatever looks cool. where have we not put a camera before? It doesn't have to make sense for the story. It doesn't make sense for a character. It's just, oh, that shot would look sick. Let's do that. Which, you know, there are worse things, but it gets worse and worse as time goes on. And like, there are shots where it would just be a normal dialogue driven scene between two characters, and the camera will be at like someone's feet looking all the way up at them, and it serves nothing. It makes the scenes incoherent. You don't know what you're supposed to pay attention to. His plots are always convoluted. You can't follow it. Some other, I don't mean to rag on him too much, because there are good things about Michael Bay, and I, again, I watch what he does, so I'm in some ways a fan. But a few other things, his sense of humor is probably the worst thing about all of his filmmaking. And you can tell he thinks these jokes, which are pretty constant, are so funny. Like, I could just see him like laughing in the director's chair. Like, these are hysterical jokes. And they're so, I don't mind juvenile jokes. I have a very childlike sense of humor, so I'm all for stupid stuff, but it's so in your face, so constant, that it just becomes like eye roll. A few other aspects that are very iconic Michael Bayisms are every woman in his, or at least every young woman in his movies, look like Victoria's Secret models. He always shoots them in the most like sexist, shallow way possible, and dresses them in the most skimpy way. Then even Sam Witwicky's perception or interest in Megan Fox, where it's just the classic nerdy, oh, this girl is so hot, like, how am I going to talk to her? I'm such a nerd. And then it's just so like cringe, high school boy, immature sort of mentality. And whenever there's interactions between possible romantic partners, it's brutal. Then most of his characters have only interests in things like money, you know, getting rich, getting with Victoria's Secret model-like women, driving cool cars, and a few of those things, and in little increments, that's fine. Like, it's everybody's shallow sometimes. Everybody likes superficial things. That's just life. But it's in all of his movies, no matter what the story is, there's always those elements. I'd say 99 times out of 100. And that's what really turns me off into really appreciating him more. But some good elements that make his movies very interesting and exciting to watch sometimes is the term Bayhem, which is, I don't know if there's an exact definition, but it's really his signature style of action where there's constant motion on screen and really no one else does action like he does. And that is something that's impressive on its own, right? You really have created and influenced action a lot in modern blockbusters. That's not easy to do. And if you look at these films, if you look at Bad Boys, he's able to create very dynamic action where, you know, there's stuff in the foreground, middle ground, background, all moving in different ways. There's explosions, there's cars driving this way, there's planes flying in, there's stuff that is being alluded to off screen that makes the action even bigger, like in Pearl Harbor, for example. So that I enjoy. You know, there's time and place where I'm like, this is so freaking cool, for sure. Not only that, but the CGI, even in this film for 2007, looks fantastic. Like, there are a few little things that aren't as sharp as later films, obviously, but for a 2007 film, the effects look pretty darn good. Like, the Transformers look awesome. All the different pieces and mechanics of all that looks really good. And then he uses a lot of practical explosions, which, that's one more thing, is all of his explosions in his films look like firework explosions, which that's not really a good thing or a bad thing. It's just a certain style, identifiable trait, I guess. But what makes all those elements, besides what I've already talked about, what makes those elements lesser or makes his overall movies lesser is he can't just have a 90-minute Bayhem movie. He has to have a 3-hour epic with 2 hours of plot, and you're so exhausted by the end. Like, for example, watching this movie or watching all of these in a short period of time, not just one after another, but even in the span of a week, is not good for your health. Like, I felt like my eyes were burned off because of the explosions, the constant looks into the sun, the lens flares. I'm surprised I didn't get a seizure when I watched a lot of these in fairly quick succession. So that's what's exhausting about Michael Bay is he can't just make a short movie, or at least 9 times out of 10, he can't. And I, you know, it's Transformers. You want it to be bigger, but there's a point. Some other specifics about this one. I think the overall setup with the Transformers kind of coming out of nowhere and then just the world having to deal with it. And Josh Duhamel, who plays this military guy, not a huge fan. I think he's pretty bland, and he appears in so many of these. I just think he's a really lame action hero. Not to say he's a bad actor, but really pretty vanilla. I do also like the relationship and ongoing relationship with Bumblebee and Sam Witwicky. I just like the character or transformer of Bumblebee. I think that's a really cool choice. I like the yellow design. I at least get somewhat invested in that relationship. I think it's better in the Bumblebee movie, which we'll get to, but it's all right in this. And I like the car, the old-fashioned car of Bumblebee's. The scene where Bumblebee rescues Sam in that kind of warehouse factory junkyard place, I think is a pretty good scene. And before I forget, another really cringe-worthy element. I guess they're memorable because of how bad they are. Maybe that's the point. But Sam Witwicky's parents are just horrible characters. Like, they're so obnoxious, and how they constantly baby him. And I know that's meant to be humor, but they're terribly written characters, and it gets worse in part 2 and 3. The climactic fight with the Autobots and Decepticons in the city, really good, and that goes back to the Bayhem action, which that's a situation where it works, and it's really cool. And my teenage boy comes out, and I geek out over all that. Another criticism that I even noticed before I even read that it was a criticism of the general masses is with Michael Bay's signature camera works, like, for example, the iconic one where there's a character on the ground and they see like a car flying over them or a transformer or whatever, and there's that very epic swirling aerial shot, which a lot of people have copied. That is something which, hey, that's cool on its own. But then when you see it in Bad Boys, when you see it in Transformers, when you see it in all these other films that he's done, it's like, dude, change it up. Because so many other filmmakers at his stature, at his level, sure, they have signatures, but most of the time, they find ways of keeping it more subtle and not incorporating it into the same exact sequences, whereas Michael Bay is all about action. And so regardless of the situation, he says, all right, well, let's just do it again. It'll look cool. Again, it's all about what looks cool. And he doesn't care if he's done it before, and most people don't seem to mind considering how much money he makes in his films. He also does a lot of, not a lot, it's more so in Bad Boys, but the signature 360 pan where everything is swiveling around the room or whatever, that's all right by itself and iconic, I guess. So, as much as I have hated on him already, he clearly does have many identifiable traits that a lot of other filmmakers can't necessarily say, or I could say about them myself. So, for better or for worse, he's memorable. And sometimes that's all it takes to be successful, is it sticks with you for whatever reason. It's so bad it's good, or it's so ridiculous, or it's so exaggerated that it works for you, you know? And yeah, I don't have a lot of other points about this one. We'll get to, we have 4 more Michael Bay films to talk about, so plenty more Bay to come. That one is a heavy 3.5 out of 5.